Hey. Great job. Wow. What a joy to be here with you all. I really mean that. It's an honor. I have a long history, almost 20 years with Harvest. You all don't know this. Many of you don't. Some of you might. But, 19 years ago makes me feel old. One of my sons went to Moody. And guess what church he went to? Harvest. He would be right in there playing drums now and then, led worship for the college group. It really shaped his life. He's a church planner now, he's married, has three great kids, and you all built into my family. Those of you that are parents, who do you really love? You love people that help your kids, right? Well, you guys weren't done. Then Annie had a heart for ministry. She's my youngest, and she went to Moody. Guess where she went to church? Harvest. And wow, you built into her life. And she's now a bit older, four little kids, leads a ministry with young moms. And then there's that one other son that you probably, some of you know better. And Jason has been partnered up with Vertical Worship for over a decade. And when I talk to him about what you all have done in his life, so when I was asked, could I come? I said, are you kidding? I'm honored to come. I mean, you've shaped my family. You've been a part of the journey. I've been a pastor for a little over 35 years, which is crazy. I thought I was going to be a basketball coach all my life. And in October, some things happened with living on the edge, and I'll leave tomorrow for China. It'll be my third trip there in the last 11 months, and some things in the Middle East. And one of the teaching pastors just became our new senior pastor, so he's my pastor now. And I just have to tell you, I think in 35 years, maybe there was one Sunday in my life that I was free on Easter. And so I get to come here and do this with you. So before I start, thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Now, Lord, I want to thank you and ask that you would grant us together ears to hear. Lord, would you take the written word and make it living? Would you make our hearts open and objective? We're asking in advance that you would speak. Lord, I pray that you would activate my gift, give me a supernatural love for the people in this room, and that you would choose to speak what you want to say through me. And Lord, I can't do this apart from you, but I thank you that you've promised that you love these people and that you will speak to them. In Christ's name, amen. Well, I did not grow up as a Christian. And I didn't go to a church like Harvest. I went to a church where they didn't believe the Bible. And hypocrisy was sort of the state of the church. People said one thing, lived another way. So by about 15 or 16, it was, I'm done with God, done with church. I don't believe any of this stuff. And I just went my own way. My dad was a pretty functioning alcoholic until I got into the middle or late high school. Understandably so. 16 years old, went into the service, World War II, Guam, Iwo Jima, Purple Heart. He was wounded, and they carried him out, and none of his buddies made it out. That was in the day where they didn't do counseling, and my dad had anger issues and hurt issues and nightmares for 40 years, and so he drank, and he wasn't around. And so in the midst of that, coaches really made a big difference in my life, and it was really a coach who paid my way to go to a, talk about the value of a camp. He paid my way to a Fellowship of Christian Athletes camp. I'd never opened the Bible before, and I met people who didn't tell me about God. They loved me, and they showed me, and something happened. We didn't use the Bible where I went to church, and a guy would get up, and he would read just a small paragraph, and instead of a bunch of high language, just down to earth, this is what it means. There's a real God. That he's personal, that he really loves you, that this is his word. And that was the beginning of a journey. I trusted Christ at that camp, then went away to college on a basketball scholarship. And there was a bricklayer there who started a little Bible study with three of us. About 2.5 years later, there was 250 students. It was a movement of God on our secular campus. And I like to say that actually my college years were like, if there was ever a season that was just awesome. And so my life was radically changed, so much so that I remember one year after I trusted Christ, went away to school, my dad said, "Hey, what's with you?" And my dad had some anger issues, so when he said that, it was not always a good moment, you know? "Well, what do you mean, Dad?" He says, "There's something different about you." I said, "Well, like what?" And they said, "You've got this peace. How did you get it?" And I didn't know very much yet. I'd only been reading the New Testament for about a year. I said, "Well, Dad, I started reading the New Testament." And so he's a Marine. Okay. So he gets up at 5 a.m. and reads the Bible for an hour for 6 months. He comes to me and says, "You know, I don't know how you get it, but it has something to do with faith." I said, "Well, Dad, sounds good. You know, I wish I could have told him." So at the end of those college years, I just thought I could not wait. I was going to be a basketball coach. In fact, I coached 2, 3, 4 years before I never dreamed that I would ever be a pastor. And at the end of my college, I had a pivotal moment that changed the trajectory of my life. I majored in an area, and I had the chairman of the department. We called him Dr. P because his name was hard to pronounce. He was brilliant, had that white hair. I really liked him. There's certain people in school that are super smart, and there's some people that are good students. I was the latter. I sort of had this knack of knowing what might be on the test. And so I did really well in my major, and he liked me, and I liked him. And so I'm getting ready to walk across the stage, and I can tell you, you ever have one of those moments imprinted in your mind where you could push a button and the video can play, almost like it was yesterday? This was one of those moments, and Dr. P, he crossed his arms and his head tilted. I can still remember it was a brick building with ivy in the background. He said, "Chip, just something about you, it's hard for me to understand." I said, "Well, what's that, Dr. P?" He said, "For someone as well-educated as you are and as intellectually astute as you appear to be, how in the world can you believe in a literal Jesus and the Bible and all this born-again stuff? I don't get it." And it wasn't like he was down on me. It was like a professor that sort of had some high hopes for his student. And he's thinking, you know, this kid's going to waste his life on all this religious trash. And then he started asking me some questions. "How can you think that one religion is better than all the others? And the Bible's been translated all this time. And, you know, I just don't get it." And I remember having a crisis of faith. You don't have to raise your hand, but any of you had some of those? I mean, like, whoa. It's not like, is that verse true or that? What about everything? And three decisions came out of that moment, graduating from college. Number one, that I was not going to throw my brains in the trash to be a follower of Christ. I honestly went through, well, maybe this is an emotional experience, and, you know, I'm young and idealistic. Maybe it's just sort of a college moment. And if I have to throw my brains in the trash to follow Christ, I just won't follow him. Second decision was, I'm not going to let someone who's very bright that I respect in academia intimidate me to give up my faith just because I respect him. And then the third decision is sort of what I want to share with you all. I decided that no matter what it takes, I'm going to take all the hard questions Dr. P asked me, and I'm going to do the research, and I'm going to explore, and I'm going to ask God, but I'm going to do whatever it takes to find out what the answers are, and I'm going to let the chips fall where they may. If this is true, then I'm going to follow Christ. If it doesn't hold up philosophically, historically, scripturally, forget it. I won't be a follower. And so you'll notice on your notes, these are the issues, and I'd like you to follow along. And it's, do you have to throw your brains in the trash to believe in Christ? Is what's true, as you're told today, just a matter of opinion or personal preference? You have your truth, right? I have my truth. We're all kind of right. Is there intellectually, is it feasible to have a personal faith in the Jesus of the Bible who doesn't claim to be just moral or a good teacher, but in fact claims to be God, claims to be the only way, claims to be one with the Father and the only way for eternal life? And I don't know about you, but those are big questions in our day. And I'd like you to listen. I know we have a mixed group here, and when I grew up, I went to church like on Easter and Christmas and a few times in between, like especially if my basketball career wasn't going well, or, you know, I broke up with a girlfriend, that's a good time to go to church, you know, and that's sort of, I had that bargaining relationship with God, but I was a skeptic. If you're like just here and like came with a friend, I want you to just with an open mind say, I wonder if this makes intellectual sense. Second, if you're here as a follower of Christ, I want you to know that your kids and your grandkids and your friends, that what is happening in our world today is that it's not enough to know what you believe. You better understand and communicate and pass on why you believe it, and it better make sense, and you better have convictions, because it's going to get more and more and more unpopular and difficult. I've spent the last 25 years of ministry in the Bay Area, one place called Santa Cruz that thinks Berkeley's too far right. Do the math on that one. We're the most educated city in all of America. People come from all over the world in the Silicon Valley where I live. 15 of the top 20 tech companies in all the world. In fact, where I've been teaching and preaching the last 10 years, we simultaneously translate in Chinese and Korean because it's a very multicultural, very bright. Everyone you meet, they're in the tech world. And I've learned in my journey there that, you know what, it's not enough to say, I love Jesus. They want to know, what about this and what about that? And what I've also learned is that in the world that we live in today, it really isn't very helpful to say, you ought, you should, I'm right, you're wrong. I've just found that when you build a relationship and you love people and you really care about them, you know, over a cup of coffee, you can say, this is why I believe what I believe. Why do you believe what you believe? And you start a relationship and a dialogue. And so you might be surprised, but there's something that atheists and the Apostle Paul agree on 100%. Do you realize that? I mean, they are just super tight on this one thing. And this one thing is that everything rises and falls with the resurrection. I mean, there might be a hard passage here and there's difficult issues over there, but if Jesus rose from the dead, he was fully God, came back to life, and that's true, that's the greatest evidence. Anthony Flew, leading atheist of the last century and the turn of the century, writes this in a debate with a Christian philosopher. He says, the physical, literal, bodily resurrection is the best, if not the only reason for accepting that Jesus is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. We both agree, this Christian debater with him, that the identification in defining and distinguishing the characteristics of two Christians, that it is scarcely possible to make it without also accepting the resurrection did literally happen. Pretty amazing. Listen to the Apostle Paul, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He says, for if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Then those who also have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of most men to be pitied. And so I want you for just a little while to put on your thinking cap and follow along with me and think deeply. We've had a great celebration. We've had great emotion. We've had a great time. God has changed people's lives. We've witnessed baptism. Now here's what I want you to do. We're supposed to love God, right? With all of our heart, with all of our mind, and all of our strength. I want you to really think with me. Open your notes, and here were the things that I had to ask about the resurrection to come to grips with. Can this be true or not? Question number one, did Jesus really exist? I was on a plane with a Google guy recently. He's from India, very smart guy. And he kind of turned to me after about an hour of conversation, and we're talking about he's a young dad. He wants to be a good dad. And he said, you know, like, is Jesus like a made-up story, like King Arthur or the Titans? Or, I mean, did he exist, and how do you even know he really existed? And that's a question I had. We have 25,000 manuscripts in the first century. The most authentic document in all of antiquity is this Bible, both Old and New Testament. We have extra-biblical sources. In other words, I don't just believe the Bible. We have Tacitus, who is a Roman historian. We have Josephus, who is a Jewish historian. We have someone, Pliny the Younger, during the time of Jesus, writing about this historical person. We know, have more factual evidence that Jesus was an actual person, lived in Palestine, started a movement, than that Homer or Shakespeare or most historical figures ever lived. Second, then, what was he like? The historicity of Jesus is airtight. In other words, he really lived, was a real person. The second question is, what was he really like? And his character is undisputed. friend or foe, he was loving, kind, compassionate. He was the one that cared about the leper. He was the one that women were an object, not even a personhood in the first century. And Jesus had women to be the first person who would testify of his resurrection. He cared about people. He loved people. Mercy was seen as weakness in the first century. Rome was brutal. The life expectancy for most people was 29 to 35 years old. I mean, 80% of the people were slaves. There was disease. There was suffering. There was this brutal Roman concept of just moving people out of the way. Friend and foe would say Jesus was loving and pure and kind. I mean, even in our day, Gandhi was a great, he didn't follow Jesus. Are you ready why? He said, this Jesus so enthralls my life and I want to learn his principles. And as a young man, he went to Africa and lived with a missionary couple for 6 to 8 months. And their private life in their home was so different than what they were saying. Gandhi would say, this Jesus is so attractive, but so many of his people are so much unlike him. That was my experience. In Islam, Jesus is a great figure. Where I live, the New Age is huge and big. We talk about the Christ consciousness. Every time you jot down the date, you are saying that the most singular, important person of impact on the face of the earth, right? It's April 21, 2019 AD, the year of our Lord. How could one man, without an army, without satellites, without a mobile phone, without the printing press, live upon the earth, get a group of 12 people that grew to maybe 120 that were really pretty committed, claim to be God? In fact, are you ready for this? John 8:46, which one of you convicts me of sin? If I speak the truth, why do you not believe me? See, here's what you got to get about this Jesus. He won't allow us, even Christians, to say, oh yeah, you know, I agree with most of everything. He claimed to be sinless. I mean, the whole movement gets stopped if someone just says, I saw him lie or steal or break one of the commandments. But no one ever caught him. So just the logic is he's a real person. You may not believe that he's God, but he's the singular greatest character. How many of you would like your kids to grow up and act and be and think a lot like Jesus? How many would you like to marry someone that is a lot like Jesus? How many people are going, you know what, that Christianity, the one thing I would never want, I don't want my kids growing up like Jesus, you know, telling the truth, being compassionate, loving people, caring for, right? I mean, no one argues with this. I mean, he's highly esteemed in other world religions everywhere. Well, then the next question he asks is, did he really do those miracles? I mean, is that just fairy tales? I mean, most world religions and movements, they have stories about people that do, quote, miracles, or so they say, and they usually happen in some part of the world or in the Amazon or in Tibet, and then they come over and give a seminar, and we're supposed to believe that happened. The works of Jesus went unchallenged. He fed 5,000. The way they counted 5,000 men, they were probably counting women and children there, maybe 10, 15, 20,000 people. He healed two or three people that we just recorded in the New Testament. Some he raised from the dead. You know, here, follow this. Jesus did this. Jerusalem, Judea, was not that big a place. Some say maybe 100, 150,000 people total in the whole area. Thousands of people were following him. If you were one of the 15 or 20,000 people, you saw the bread, the fish, guess what? Your network, what did you do? You didn't go on social media. People would talk to each other back then. They would hang out and, you know, talk one another in the market. You would meet someone who was the leper's mother. You would meet friends that were there when the little girl was raised from the dead. It got so amazing that he could never go to a city because he was overwhelmed with the crowds. And it's not like it just happened. It happened for 3 years. So there was visual, verifiable, did he do the miracle or not? In fact, Peter would even come to the point where when he did the great sermon in Acts 2, this Jesus whom you crucified, God made both Lord and Christ, attested to you by signs and wonders and miracles. Because everyone knew in the whole area, this miracle-working guy, they didn't necessarily believe he was God. But here's what I want you to get. When you think through what you believe and why you believe it, he's a historical figure who lived an amazing life, who did miracles that were undeniable. Here's the catch. Here's where it gets a little tricky. Did he really claim to be God? Secular scholars will say, you know, Christianity grew and he was a great teacher, was a moral teacher. And then decades later, or some would say even 100 or 2 years later, his followers went back in and they made up that he said he was God to bolster the movement. Notice I put in your notes, I'll go through it briefly, but here's what Jesus claimed: I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. He dies, is raised from the dead. It's only 2 months later when the Holy Spirit comes and the church is birthed. We have all eyewitnesses of what he said about himself. We know that in at least on two different occasions, God would speak and say, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." We know he asked the disciples, "Who do men say that I am?" They say, "Well, some people think you're Elijah. Some people, maybe John the Baptist, come back from the dead. Who do you say that I am?" You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus clearly claims that he is God and the Savior of the world, even his enemies. John chapter 10, verse 33, he's in dialogue with them and they want to put him to death. And his response is, he answered the Jews, he said, "For what good work? We do not stone you, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself out to be God." Now, because I am an honest skeptic, I mean, even to this day, when I read a book and I hear some fantastic Christian this or Christian that, and part of me hates to admit it, but part of me, like we're all wired a different way, when I hear someone on TV or I read a book, the first thing I think is, "Eh, maybe. I don't know that I buy that. I'm going to check it out myself. I don't care how famous they are. I don't care how many books they've written." When I have a conversation with someone, so if you're talking to me, beware, right? And you tell me something, I'm sorry, I don't mean this badly. I'm just not like a trusting person. I'm like, okay, based on what? How did you get here? Is that the whole truth? Are you exaggerating? So if I was a skeptic today, and I pray some people where I was or sitting in the room or watching us right now, here's what I'd be thinking. Did Jesus, okay, our historical person, yeah, great, yeah, I can't argue with that. The miracles, 3 years, I can buy that. Did he really claim to be God? So far, all you gave me was circular reasoning. You quoted all this stuff out of the Bible, so, okay, you ready? What if I could tell you I have extra biblical source in the first century, within 40 years after the crucifixion, that examines what the early Christians said and who they believed Jesus? Pliny the Younger was a senator, a historian, and he was sent on an errand by the emperor to find out about this group called the Way. And he writes a note. This is a document from him, first century document, 40 years after the crucifixion. His name is Gaius Plinius Cassius Secundus, formerly or known as Pliny the Younger. I can see why they call him that. I can't even say those words. But this is what he says when he reports to the emperor concerning the Way. He said, "They're really a quite strange group of people. We question them and give them the opportunity to recant. And if they will not recant, they are put to death. In my opinion, their beliefs are very silly because they do the strangest things. They meet at dawn. They ate a common meal together. They worshiped a dead person they believed was God. And they treated each other with outstanding love and would not worship idols." All I want to say to this point is that a historical person who did miracles, who lived an exemplary life, who was a dynamic teacher, actually claimed to be God. And people will either believe that or not believe that. Here's what you can't believe. He was a great teacher. He's a great example. I want to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, and I want to be like him. Because he's someone who said, narrowly, outrageously, "If you've seen me, you've seen the Father." The kind of life he lived, you know why he lived that kind of life? John 1:18 says, "No man has seen God at any time, but he," Jesus, are you ready for this? "Explained him." Now, you've got a great history in this church. You know what the Greek word is? He exegeted him. To exegete a passage means you explain what it really means. Jesus came to explain, what's the Father like? What's the Father feel like women who are abused? How does the Father feel like lepers who are being not cared for? What's the Father feel like when people are slaves and they're prejudiced against? What's the Father feel like when people are hurting and no one cares about them? What's the Father feel like when people get religious and arrogant and think they're better than other people? Look at Jesus. That's what the Father feels like. That's why he came. He did claim to be God. And you're either in or out. Because the fact of the matter is, if he's not really God, if he's not the Savior of the world, he's a liar. Or he was nuts, deluded. The next question I had to ask was, how do you know he really died? You know, like I've seen on TV, maybe he lowered his heart rate and maybe there was a group of people that gave him some special herbs and spices that someone mixed up in the back room and he just appeared to be dead. Well, what we know is the death of Jesus was undisputed, both at the time and later. His legs were not broken because he was already dead. The flogging, if you were at the Good Friday service, how many, by the way, made it to that? Wow, I just, if you didn't, this is no, like, you oughta should have been there. No. I had the most moving experience on Good Friday I've ever had in my life. What was presented in this room on Good Friday, so my mind, my heart, the picture, what Jesus actually suffered, not just mentally, not just the separation from the Father, but even physically, it was so portrayed. And they talked about his flogging. Did he really die? They would have a pole about like this, and they would connect a leather strap to it. And about the middle of the strap, they had these balls made out of steel or some metal. And then at the end, they used either glass or bone. And so then they would wrap the person, strip them, and he would be tied to a pole like this. And then a flogging, it would be... And so the balls would hit and cause contusions and the beginning of internal bleeding. And then the glass or the bone, it would rip his flesh. And so what I want you to know is the Jesus that couldn't even hold his beam, in the Jewish law, it was forbidden to have more than 39 lashes because no one lived beyond 39 lashes. So they don't break his legs. He's within an inch of his life. He's got internal bleeding happening. And then notice the text says that they put a spear and water and blood come out. The pericardial sac is around the heart. It's a clear fluid. If you put a spear into someone's heart and water and blood are both coming out, they're dead. The Roman guards, he's dead. Pontius Pilate, he's dead. Here's the burial. And then they take about 70 pounds of linen and spices and aloe, and they wrap him up. The next question that I had to ask was, well, maybe his disciples stole the body. And I don't know about you, I didn't know anything about tombs, but last year I had a chance to go to Israel and do some teaching. And rather than me tell you, I want you to get a very clear picture of exactly what's happening. So keep your thinking cap on.
I'm standing here in front of the garden tomb. This is the very place that people believe that Jesus rose from the dead. Now, others would say it's maybe in a place very close down the road, but here's what we know for sure. It's in a tomb just like this. Now, the challenge during that time was that people actually were fearful that the disciples would come and steal the body. But a tomb like this was of a wealthy person. Joseph of Arimathea had donated his tomb. And what you need to know about a tomb like this is that there's a huge stone, thousands and thousands of pounds, and it would be rolled right into this location. So it would take four or five people to roll a stone like that into this groove. But it's well beyond that. The Jewish leaders went to Pilate and they said, you know, this Jesus guy said that he was going to come back to life, and we need to make sure that the disciples don't steal the body. And so they wanted Roman guards. So they had Roman guards stationed here. And you need to think of Roman guards like a special ops force. I mean, these guys were the cutting edge military of the day. If you were a Roman guard and you fell asleep on the job, it was the death penalty. Now, that If you think that's a lot, it was even more secure. They put a Roman seal over this tomb. That meant that if anyone messed with the seal, it was a capital offense. All I can tell you is there might be a lot of explanations, but the only real explanation for anyone coming out of this tomb, Jesus the Son of God, is a supernatural miracle. It was secure by the guards. It was secure by how heavy it was. Some say it would take as many as 20 people to move that big stone. Can you imagine on a morning like this, as women came to prepare the body, and this huge stone is rolled away, and angels are speaking to them? It's quiet here. I just have a sense of the miraculous moment that occurred just like this. In fact, let me read the passage. I want you to capture from Luke chapter 24 exactly what happened. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and they went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled from the tomb, but when they entered, they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. The truth of Jesus' death, his burial, his security, his resurrection is so strong. He's risen from the dead.
What I want you to know is that when I went to college, I went there to be a lawyer. I dreamed the day of trying cases, and I think God made my brain to take evidence, align it, figure out what it says, weigh it, and then say, okay, what's true, what you can trust? Now we're going to really shift gears. Okay, any intellectual, honest person can say, Jesus actually lived. He was a historical figure. We can know that he lived this exemplary life. There were miracles verified in his day. We know that he claimed, and the early church claimed, he was God. He actually did die. He was actually buried. Now, here's the deal. When you look at all the evidence, is it beyond a reasonable doubt that this is true? Because this is a yes or no proposition. This isn't Jesus is nice, Jesus is a moral teacher, Jesus set a great example. This is the Jesus that said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. This is the Jesus that says, I am the way, the truth, the life. It's narrow, it's outrageous, but what if it's true? And when you go to college, or whether you're in college, or your neighbor, or your coworker, or the person on the job site, or in your cubicle, or the person where you sit down and have coffee, and they see you with a Bible or writing in a journal, and they ask you about your faith, is it like, oh, well, whatever you believe is fine, but I just happen to believe in Jesus, and he did something, I had a liver quiver experience, and I have my experience. You know what you're going to hear is, that's nice, you have your truth, I have my truth. Jesus said, go into all the world. There's a reason I'm going to China. I'm going to meet with people that have come to a conviction and a decision that they are willing to die or go to prison because of what Jesus has done for them. And it's the largest church in the world in the midst of great persecution. So let's look at the evidence. How would the resurrection claim stand up in a court of law? And in a court of law, what? Beyond a reasonable doubt. Now here's what I want you to get. Every person in this room is living by faith. Every single one of you. You have dreams, you have jobs, you have thoughts. You're either moral about this issue or that issue, but it's all based on something, isn't it? You're all living by faith. Everyone has either thought about it deeply or not thought at all, and something's going to happen after you die. Now, what's your belief, and why do you believe that? Something's going to happen about how you make your decisions and your relationships. And all of that is based on you have a faith system that you are believing that this will bring life or success or a good or a bad outcome. So let me look at the evidence. Number one, it was predicted by the Old Testament prophets. They said he would be buried where? Among the wicked. 700 years in a rich man's tomb. They said he'd be betrayed by 30 pieces of silver, that he would come in on a donkey. They said that he'd be born of a virgin. They said it'd be from the tribe of Judah. I mean, Psalm 22 talks about they pierced my hands and my side. Psalm 22 is written before crucifixion was ever invented. 700 years earlier, we are told that there will be one who has come, the suffering servant, fully God, fully man, to be the Messiah or the Savior of the world, Jesus and his ministry. Over and over and over, if you take the whole book, read the book of Mark real quickly, only 16 chapters. The first 8 chapters, he comes, he heals, he teaches, and then he gets to the apex of the book in chapter 8. Who do men say that I am? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then what's he say? Now, I must suffer at the hands of the chief priests and the teachers of the law, and I will die, and on the third day I'll raise again. So he tells all of them in advance, this is going to happen to me. Third, he appeared in 12 different times to over 500 eyewitnesses. I've been on 3 juries in my life and been the foreman on 2 of them. And I've sat with 11 people agonizing for 2 or 3 days, and we have 2 eyewitnesses about did that guy sell drugs and kill that guy or not. And we have to make a decision, and we're going to base it on these 2 eyewitnesses, and we send people to jail forever, or we set someone free based on 2 eyewitnesses. We had 500 eyewitnesses, Jesus in a resurrected body, not for a day, not for an event, not some guy that had a dream, not some guy who went up on a mountain and tells us this is how we ought to live, not some pie in the sky spirituality. He says, I'm the Messiah. And it was verified. And 2 months later, in the same place where it all happened, where you could meet the people that saw him, that's where the church grew. This isn't an accident. We're going to live our lives by faith, but God has gone to great lengths to give us great evidence. Notice the explosion of the early church, transformation of the disciples. What happens to a guy that 2 months earlier, I don't know him. I don't blankety blank know him. Remember Peter? I mean, he was afraid of everybody. He's afraid of a servant girl. A couple months later, 3,000 people trust Christ. 11 of the 12 disciples all give their lives and are martyred. You think they gave their life for a lie? Now, we know we're living in a world where people will die for what they believe is true, right? It's tragic. 12-year-old boys, 14-year-old boys, little girls. But no one is going to knowingly give their life for what they know is not true. And all the disciples in the early church, they would march arm in arm into the stadiums, and they would pray and sing as they let wild beasts and dogs, and they would be killed. That's the history that we have. People who've given their lives because they know it's true, and they have a conviction. The Roman Empire was transformed. If you've never read anything by Rodney Stark, he's a sociologist. I really have no idea where he's coming from spiritually. But he wrote a book called The Rise of Christianity and the Triumph of Faith. I think he might teach at Baylor now. He's been at a couple places. Brilliant guy. And what he does is he explains, how is it that in 313, out of a polytheistic culture with multi-gods everywhere, this little sect of Christianity, by 313, there were 60 million people in the Roman Empire, and 33 million of them were followers of Christ. He doesn't talk about the Holy Spirit or God or what God was doing. As a sociologist, you know what he says? In the first 100 to 120 years, there were 3 major plagues that were across the Roman Empire. Whole cities wiped out. Think no vaccines when, you know, the bubonic plague or some of those diseases came. All the rich people go to the hills. 80% of the Roman Empire are slaves. The only people who stayed in the cities were the Christians. And as you read the early documents in the first few 100 years, the Christians that stayed and gave their life to nurture unbelievers back to health were viewed as martyrs. And pretty soon people come back to a city when the plague is gone, and the only people left in the city are who? You've got the Christians that survived, you have the people that came to Christ because a Christian loved me, and you have people that are non-Christians that say, I don't know much about life, but the only people that love me are these crazy Christians. Then the Christians were the crazy people that when they would take the babies day after day, infanticide is not new. They would bring a baby to a Roman father, and by and large, if he wanted a son, if it was girl, he would just command him, put it on the ash heap. They would put it on the ash heap, and the Christians, the first adopters, they changed it. Women were objects. Slaves were pieces of meat. It was the Christians that changed the face of the world. But it was by what? Their works. Their good works that glorified their Father in heaven. As I did my research, I found out that I wasn't the first person in a crisis of faith. And I found out some of the best legal minds in all the world has taken this evidence and said, is it or is it not true beyond a reasonable doubt? Simon Greenleaf was one of the co-founders of Harvard Law School. He had a student that I think bugged him a little bit, who was a Christian, talk about the Bible. He got ticked off. He said, look, I'm gonna take the rules of law and I'm gonna examine the evidence for the resurrection. And he ended up, instead of being a non-Christian professor who helped start Harvard Law School, he wrote one of the classic books. It's a real long title, The Testimony of an Evangelist with Regard to the Gospels, blah, 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 blah. Frank Morrison, attorney, had the same experience. He did the research. He ended up writing a book called Who Moved the Stone? Josh McDowell, in your Chicago, Lee Strobel. When people who are objective and aren't afraid of what everyone thinks are willing to look at the evidence, the preponderance of the evidence, knowing that everyone lives by faith, it is amazing. The preponderance of the evidence, it's an airtight case. But see, that's not what keeps most of us from becoming Christians. Jesus said, we walk in darkness and we don't want the exposure of the light. When I heard these things and when I first believed them, I had a couple areas of my life that some of you can identify with. And I thought, you know, if I'm going to be a genuine follower of Christ, it means a couple of these behaviors and relationships and how I'm doing my life, I don't want to be a hypocrite like all the people in my church. What I realized was, is that do I really believe there's a new life? For many of you, this celebration that he's alive, my prayer when I came here was that, oh God, would you help every single person like never before actually believe and grasp how much you love him? All the fun, all the joy, all the success isn't with money and power and sex and prestige. The peace and the joy and the purpose and the meaning in your life can only come from the one who created you and died in your place. The reason I became a Christian was not all these reasons. I didn't know them. The reason I became a Christian is one word, punky. Punky. It's a person. What parent would ever name their child Punky? I don't know. Except that her real name was Harriet McGregor. It was an era when people named him after their sort of relatives, and Punky was my sister. When my dad's alcoholism got really bad and there was tension in our family and he would miss supper and there was a lot of arguments and a lot of stuff, little did I know, she actually ended up with an eating disorder out of our family, and we were the classic alcoholic family. Older one, scapegoat, middle one, neglected, eating disorder, younger one, rescuer. My dad would get up and I would pour out his bottle into the sink thinking I was helping him. But Punky had a friend named Tammy. And Tammy shared Christ with Punky, and Punky came to Christ. And all I can tell you, she was the kindest, most other-centered person I had ever met. I would come in with my basketball buddies, hey, can I fix you all a sandwich? She was my biggest cheerleader, and our family's fallen apart, and all I knew that someday, some way, I wanted to be like my sister. And what I knew was, I had no idea, and she began to introduce me to the thought that maybe our experience in our church and our misgivings and all the hypocrisy isn't all that there was. See, the people in your network, you can have all the reasons in the world. I'm going to tell you what they need is to see a Jesus showing up in your home and a Jesus showing up at your work and a Jesus showing up in your neighborhood that lives inside of you, that you talk and care and love, that his life is living his life through you. And this Easter, for some of you, is going to be one of the most defining days as a believer to say, you know something? The world is getting hard. We're losing 68% of our kids 5 years after they leave our good churches like this. And the number one problem the research says is they don't see the reality of it at home. Or they realize that church is something that I attend and I listen to, and it's some sort of performance rather than I shoulder and I serve and I care. Because when God works in you and through you, then you experience that reality. By contrast, turn the back page, because this is going to be the greatest day for some of you in your entire life, other than being born. Here's what the resurrection, if in fact it's true, and I believe it is. Number one, it validates the claims of Jesus. Is it narrow? Is it outrageous? Yes, but he's God. He's the way, the truth, and the life. Second, it gives absolute hope for the future. Jesus said to those young men and the women that was with him, because I live, you live also. I'm going to get on a plane tomorrow morning and go to China. And my time in the Middle East, I actually feel pretty safe in China. In the Middle East, the last time we did a pastor's conference, about 1,400 pastors, about 2 hours outside of Cairo. And I went in to get in with the other guys, and the guy up front, I noticed he had a gun. And then there's an SUV and a lot of guys with machine guns. And I kind of turned to him and said, hey, there's a lot of guns. And they said, be glad we have a lot of guns. These kind of events, sometimes a bomb goes off. We may be stopped along the way. And you know, I had this experience. Are you ready? I realized, you know, I'm not afraid to die. Maybe more importantly, I'm not afraid to live. Did you realize how many of you, how many of us live your life afraid of what people think, afraid of what might happen, afraid of this, afraid of that? When you embrace the living God and his spirit lives in you, you are free to be you. Because at the end of the day, actually no one is really thinking about you. They really don't care about you. I mean, they don't. Don't humor yourself. What will they think? I got news. No one's getting up going, wow, I wonder how so-and-so is. And no one, what they think. Honestly, they don't care. But God does. God does. You know, I put a little thing here. He offers spiritual life, and for some of you, it's right now. I'm going to read the most famous NFL plaque in the world. It's called John 3:16, right? In the end zone. And I'm going to read it, and I'm going to read it for me, but I want you to, you can just whisper, because if you all yell it, it would be a little inappropriate. But I want, where there's blanks, I want you to whisper your name to yourself. Are you ready? You can even write it while you whisper if you want. God so loved Chip that he gave his one and only son, that if Chip believes in him, Chip shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn Chip, but to save Chip through him. As you whispered your name, God's not down on you. He brought you in this room on this day to love you, to forgive you, and give you new life. What will you do with the evidence? You know, when I was on those juries, here's the deal. We couldn't say, well, you know what? Could we think about this later, maybe like a couple years from now? We were stuck in a room, and we had to say, guilty or not guilty? And if you're in the jury and God has given you this evidence on this day, are you going to say, I accept it or I reject it? I'm going to pray in just a minute. And I've been down this road for a while, so I know there's a battle going on in some of your hearts, like, oh my, there's something happening, and I think this is right, I think this is right, but what about this? I think it's right, what about this, and what would so-and-so think? Forget all that. Just respond to the Holy Spirit's nudge. And finally, for some of you that are like me, that are skeptics, and this has introduced something. You're not ready to pray a prayer. You're the kind of people that think things through. Will you explore or forget it? I literally live with the smartest people probably in the world. And I'm amazed that with all their brilliance, they're more caught up in creating the new chip, getting their company to go public, or their life busy with stuff, to stop and say, maybe I should consider the most important thing in all the world, my current life and my eternity. Unless something dramatic happens, 100% of us will die. We will. And after that, what? Jesus would say, I brought you in this room or in one of those campuses on this day to say, come to me. Will you let me forgive you? Would you be willing to bow the knee and say, Lord Jesus, I am not perfect. I need you. I'm asking you right now to forgive me and come into my life. Will you bow your head with me? If you are one of those who God has spoken to and you want to take that next step, would you just whisper this and pray after me? Would you say, Lord Jesus, I need you today. I know I've done many things wrong. I'm not perfect. And you're a holy God. And so today I believe you, Jesus, died in my place. I trust that you rose from the dead to prove it's true. And I ask you right now to come into my life. Your word says, as many as receive you, to them you give right to become the children of God. Right now, make me your son. Make me your daughter. And before I talk to my brothers and sisters, if you prayed with me, would you just put your hand up real high? No one else, just you and me. Just put it up. This is your day. We believe with our heart. We profess with our mouth. It's really important you go public. There's no secret agent Christians. Just put it up. Great. Yeah, great. Great. Fantastic. Lord, I want to pray now for my brothers and sisters. It's a new world that we live in. If you've been drifting and you realize I need my life to be aligned with the priorities of what's true, of what I say I believe, would you right now have a very private conversation? And would you say, Lord, is there anything between us or anything I'm doing that is keeping your grace and your power from making me the kind of Christian that you could use to love others and give me the kind of joy and love you want me to have? And then privately, could you say, I'm coming back. Will you be the Lord of my life? I'm all in. In Jesus' name, amen.